Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Microbiology for Dummies by Julienne C. Kaiser, PhD, Jennifer C. Stearns, PhD, and Michael G. Surette, PhD. Narrated by Suzie Althens. Introduction. The world around us is full of tiny, invisible living things that affect us every day. Diving into the study of that world is what this book is all about, and we're happy that you'd like to come along. Microbiology as a whole can feel overwhelming, but when you break it down into parts, it can be straightforward and even interesting. Whether you're taking a microbiology course for credit or studying microbiology on your own time, we've written this book with you, the beginner, in mind. This book walks you through the tricky concepts in microbiology while covering the forms, functions, and impacts of microbes in nature and on our lives. About this book. Microbiology for Dummies is an overview of the material covered in a typical first-year microbiology course. Some courses cover more medical, molecular, or environmental microbiology than others, so we've included them all here. In this book, you will find clear explanations of the characteristics that microorganisms share, the things that make microbes different from one another and the rest of life on Earth, the processes important to microbial life, the diversity of microbial life, how microbes affect us. With this book, you'll be able to explain what makes microorganisms unique and identify where and how they live. You'll also have the skills to delve into specialized areas of microbiology that this book covers in an introductory way. This book is a reference, which means you don't have to memorize it. Unlike your microbiology course, there is no test at the end. Use it as a reference, dipping into whichever chapter or section has the information you need. Finally, sidebars and sections marked with the technical stuff icons are skippable. They offer a more in-depth discussion of a topic, extra detail, or interesting cases that are related to the main material of the chapter. Foolish assumptions. We don't assume that you have any background knowledge in microbiology except what may be covered in an introductory biology course. In fact, many of the concepts learned in a biology course are also presented here, so we don't expect you to know much of that either. We assume that you are new to microbiology or other science courses where an introduction to microbiology is beneficial. And we've written this book in a way that will provide you with the background you need. The science of microbiology involves knowing a bit of biochemistry, cell biology, molecular biology, and environmental science, so we explain those concepts as needed, but you may like to peruse guides on those topics for a fuller understanding. Other than that, we only assume that you transcend the idea of microorganisms as bad and consider them as important members of our world, especially because they outnumber us about 200 million trillion to one. Icons used in this book. Icons are verbalized in this audiobook. Draw your attention to things that occur on a regular basis. Here's what each icon means. Tip. The tip icon marks material that's useful for thinking about a concept in another way, or helping you to remember something. Remember. The Remember icon highlights concepts that are important to keep in mind. Often, these concepts come up more than once in the book. Warning. The Warning icon points out places where it can be easy to get confused. We usually know this because there is confusion in the general public about the concept, or worse, in the scientific community. Sometimes the warning icon points to areas of debate in microbiology so that you don't have to feel confused if other sources disagree with our explanation. Technical stuff. Non-essential but helpful and interesting information is marked by the technical stuff icon. Beyond the Book. In addition to the material that you're hearing right now, this book also has some useful digital content available on the web. Some facts in microbiology are handy to have at your fingertips, either to study for an exam or to refresh your memory on the spot. Check out the free cheat sheet at dummies.com/cheat sheet/microbiology for tips on identifying microbes, remembering the basic differences between them, and figuring out the naming system used in microbiology. Ever wonder what all the fuss is about fecal transplants, or if the anti-vaccine campaigns are telling you the truth? You can find articles on these topics and more at dummies.com/extras/microbiology. Where to go from here? We'd like to think that you won't skip anything, but if you're taking a microbiology course right now, then you probably don't need an introduction to the topic and can skip part one. Even though each chapter can be listened to on its own, the material in part two is essential to any student of microbiology and will likely be very useful when covering more advanced topics. There are many kinds of microbiology, perspectives from which will shape how introductory biology is taught. For a human health perspective, focus on chapters in part five. For an ecology perspective, you'll likely find chapters in part three useful. No matter where you start or where you end, we hope that you'll come away with an appreciation for microbes and a roadmap for learning microbiology. Part 1. Getting Started with Microbiology. Web Extras. For Dummies can help you get started with lots of subjects. Visit dummies.com to learn more and do more with For Dummies. In this part, get a big picture view of microbiology, including how microorganisms impact our lives in ways that we can and can't see. Get acquainted with the history of microbiology from before people knew that microbes existed to our current use of sophisticated techniques to study microorganisms. Gain an understanding of the vastness of microbial lifestyles and how microbes are everywhere living in communities. Understand microbial diversity and all the different ways these tiny organisms have figured out to get energy from their environments. Chapter 1. Microbiology and You. In this chapter, seeing the importance of microbiology. Getting to know microorganisms. Listing the tools used to study microbes. When considering the imperceptibly small, it's sometimes easy to lose sight of the big picture. In this chapter, we put the science of microbiology into perspective for you as it relates to human lives, as well as how it fits in with the other sciences. The goal is to give you an idea of the kinds of thinking you'll use throughout the rest of the book. Don't worry. We explain all that pesky biochemistry and molecular biology as it comes up in each chapter. Why microbiology? The question of why to study microbiology is a good one. The impacts of microorganisms on your life may not be immediately obvious. But the truth is, microorganisms not only have a huge impact, but are literally everywhere, covering all the surfaces of your body and in every natural and urban habitat. In nature, microorganisms contribute to biogeochemical cycling, as well as turnover of material in soil and aquatic habitats. Some are important plant symbionts, organisms that live in intimate contact with their host, with mutual benefit for both organisms, whereas others are important pathogens, organisms that cause disease, of both plants and animals. Although not all microorganisms are bad, the treatment and prevention of the diseases caused by bacteria, viruses, protozoa, and fungi have only been possible because of microbiology. Antibiotics were discovered through microbiology, as were vaccines and other therapeutics. Other applications of microorganisms include industries like mining, pharmaceuticals, food and beverages, and genetics. Microorganisms are important model organisms for studying principles of genetics and biochemistry. Many professions require you to learn some microbiology. You may already know this because you're in a micro class as part of the training for one of them. These professions include, but are not limited to, nursing, medicine, clinical laboratory work, pharmaceuticals, brewing and winemaking, environmental engineering. Introducing the microorganisms. So, what are microorganisms exactly? Microorganisms are actually a diverse group of organisms. The fact that they're micro isn't even true of all microorganisms. Some of them form multicellular structures that are easily seen with the naked eye. Remember, there are three main kinds of microorganisms based on evolutionary lines. Bacteria are a large group of unicellular organisms that scientists loosely group as gram-negative and gram-positive. But in reality, there are many different kinds. Archaea are another group of unicellular organisms that evolved, along with bacteria, several billion years ago. Many are extremophiles, meaning that they thrive in very hot or very acidic conditions. Archaea are more closely related to eukaryotes than to bacteria. Eukaryotic microorganisms are a structurally diverse group that includes protists, algae, and fungi. They all have a nucleus and membrane-bound organelles, as well as other key differences from bacteria and archaea. All the rest of the multicellular organisms on Earth, including humans, have eukaryotic cells as well. Along with the many eukaryotic microorganisms, the eukaryotes include all multicellular life on Earth, like plants, animals, and humans. Viruses are smaller than bacteria and are not technically alive on their own. They must infect a host cell to survive. Viruses are made up of some genetic material surrounded by a viral coat, but they lack all the machinery necessary to make proteins and catalyze reactions. This group also includes subviral particles and prions, which are the simplest of life forms, made of naked ribonucleic acid, RNA, or simply protein. Tip: the bacteria and archaea are often talked about together under the heading of prokaryotes because they lack a nucleus. They do share a few characteristics and aren't easily distinguished from one another at first, but they are distinct groups. Deconstructing microbiology. Microbiology involves studying microorganisms from many different angles. Each perspective uses a different set of tools from an ever-improving and changing toolbox. These include morphology, the study of the shape of cells. It is analyzed using stains and microscopy. Metabolism, how an organism gets energy from its environment and the waste it produces as a result. Metabolism is studied using principles from biochemistry. Growth, how an organism, grows. The growth of a microbe is used to see how quickly the population can divide and help to distinguish between one microbe and another. Growth is measured using principles of physics, as well as good old-fashioned counting. Qualitative measures of how growth looks are also important. Genotype, the genetic makeup of a microbial strain. Genes are studied using genetics, which has recently begun to involve a lot of molecular biology. Phenotype, the name of the observable traits of a microbe. A phenotype is due to the interaction between the constellation of genes and environmental factors. It's used to describe a microorganism and to study the function of genes. To measure a phenotype, you have to use some microbiology know-how to see changes in growth and metabolism, as well as other biochemical processes for communication and defense. Phylogeny. The history of the evolution of microorganisms. Phylogeny is important not only because it helps us identify newly discovered microbes, but also because it allows us to see how closely related different microbes are to one another. The study of a group's phylogeny involves genetics and molecular biology, as well as evolutionary biology. When you put all the pieces back together again, you have the science of microbiology. Microbiologists are some of the most creative scientists out there. They have many tools at their disposal that they can use in a variety of ways. The trick is to think up sneaky ways to study microbes, which is why the field is always evolving. Technical stuff. The term microbiology is often used to mean the study of mainly bacteria and archaea, because the study of other microbes are specialties of their own. For example, the study of viruses is virology, the study of fungi is mycology, and the study of algae is phycology. Chapter 2. Microbiology, the young science. In this chapter, remembering a time before microbiology. Discovering microorganisms step by step. Looking forward. Compared with other more ancient fields of science, microbiology is a relative baby. Physics began in ancient times, mathematics even earlier. But the knowledge of tiny living things, their biology, and their impact on human lives has only been around since the late 19th century. Until about the 1880s, people still believed that life could form out of thin air and that sickness was caused by sins or bad odors. As with other fields in science, there are two aspects to microbiology research, basic and applied. Basic microbiology is about discovering the fundamental rules governing the microbial world and studying all the variety of microbial life and microbial systems. Applied microbiology is more about solving a problem and involves using microbes and their genes or proteins for practical purposes, such as in industry and medicine. In this chapter, we introduce the key concepts and experiments that gave rise to the discovery of microbes and their importance in disease. This chapter also highlights the many different areas of study within microbiology and some advances and challenges in the prevention and treatment of infectious diseases. Before microbiology, misconceptions and superstitions. Medical practices in ancient times were all heavily tinged with supernatural beliefs. Ancient Egypt was ahead of its time in terms of medicine, with physicians performing surgery and treating a wide variety of conditions. Medicine in India was also quite advanced. Ancient Greek physicians were concerned with balancing the body's humors. The four distinct body fluids that they believed were responsible for health when in balance, or disease when out of balance. And medicine in medieval Europe was based on this tradition. None, however, had knowledge of the microbial causes of disease. Opinions about why diseases afflicted people differed between cultures and parts of society, and the treatments differed as well. Diseases were thought to be caused by bad smells, treated by removing or masking the offending odor. An imbalance in the humors of the body, treated with bleeding, sweating, and vomiting. Sins of the soul, treated with prayer and rituals. Although the concept of contagion was known, it wasn't attributed to tiny living creatures, but to bad odors or spirits, such as the devil. So, simple measures such as removing sources of infection or washing hands or surgical equipment were simply not done. Discovering microorganisms. Before microorganisms were discovered, life was not known to arise uniquely from living cells. Instead, It was thought to spring spontaneously from mud and lakes, or anywhere with sufficient nutrients in a process called spontaneous generation. This concept was so compelling that it persisted until late into the 19th century. Robert Hooke, a 17th century English scientist, was the first to use a lens to observe the smallest unit of tissues he called cells. Soon after, the Dutch amateur biologist Anton van Leeuwenhoek observed what he called animalcules with the use of his homemade microscopes. When microorganisms were known to exist, most scientists believed that such simple life forms could surely arise through spontaneous generation. So, when they heated a container, placed a nutrient broth, a mixture of nutrients that supported growth of microorganisms in these early experiments, in the container and then sealed it, and no microorganisms appeared, they believed it had to be due to the absence of either air or the vital force, whatever that was, necessary to make life. Debunking the myth of spontaneous generation. The concept of spontaneous generation was finally put to rest by the French chemist Louis Pasteur in an inspired set of experiments involving a goose-necked flask. When he boiled broth in a flask with a straight neck and left it exposed to air, organisms grew. When he did this with his goose-necked flask, nothing grew. The S shape of this second flask trapped dust particles from the air, preventing them from reaching the broth. By showing that he could allow air to get into the flask, but not the particles in the air, Pasteur proved that it was the organisms in the dust that were growing in the broth. This is the principle behind the Petri dish, used to grow bacteria on solid growth medium, made by adding a gelling material to the broth, which allows air, but not small particles, to reach the surface of the growth medium. Remember, the idea that invisible microorganisms are the cause of disease is called germ theory. This was another of the important contributions of Pasteur to microbiology. It emerged not only from his experiments disproving spontaneous generation, but also from his search for the infectious organism, typhoid, that caused the death of three of his daughters. Around the same time that Pasteur was doing his experiments, a doctor named Robert Koch was working on finding the causes of some very nasty animal diseases, first anthrax, and then tuberculosis. He devised a strict set of guidelines, named Koch's postulates, that are still used to this day to definitively prove that a microorganism causes a particular disease. Koch's four postulates are: the organism causing the disease can be found in sick individuals, but not in healthy ones. The organism can be isolated and grown in pure culture. The organism must cause the disease when it is introduced into a healthy animal. The organism must be recovered from the infected animal and shown to be the same as the organism that was introduced. Improving medicine, from surgery to antibiotics and more. Once scientists knew that microbes cause disease, it was only a matter of time before medical practices improved dramatically. Surgery used to be as dangerous as not doing anything at all. But once aseptic, sterile, technique was introduced, recovery rates improved dramatically. Hand washing and quarantine of infected patients reduced the spread of disease and made hospitals into a place to get treatment instead of a place to die. Vaccination was discovered before germ theory, but it wasn't fully understood until the time of Pasteur. In the late 18th century, milkmaids who contracted the non-lethal cowpox sickness from the cows they were milking were spared in deadly smallpox outbreaks that ravaged England periodically. The physician, Edward Jenner, used pus from the cowpox scabs to vaccinate people against smallpox. Years later, Pasteur realized that the reason this worked was that the cowpox virus was similar enough to the smallpox virus to kickstart an immune response that would provide a person with long-term protection, or immunity. Antibiotics were discovered completely by accident in the 1920s, when a solid culture in a petri dish, called a plate, of bacteria was left to sit around longer than usual. As will happen with any food source left sitting around, it became moldy, growing a patch of fuzzy fungus. The colonies in the area around the fungal colony were smaller in size and seemed to be growing poorly compared to the bacteria on the rest of the plate. The compound found to be responsible for this antibacterial action was named penicillin. The first antibiotic, penicillin, was later used to treat people suffering from a variety of bacterial infections and to prevent bacterial infections in burn victims, among many other applications. After bacteria were discovered, the field of molecular biology made great strides in understanding the genetic code, how DNA is regulated, and how RNA is translated into proteins. Until this point, research was focused mainly on plant and animal cells, which are much more complex than bacterial cells. When researchers switched to studying these processes in bacteria, many of the secrets of genes and enzymes started to reveal themselves. Technical stuff. How microorganisms are named. Microorganisms are named using the Linnaeus system developed in the 18th century. It uses two-part Latin names for all living things. The first part, which is capitalized, is a genus name given to closely related organisms. The second part is a species name, which is not capitalized, given to define a specific organism. This is more challenging than you may think, even for plants and animals, and the concept of a species of microorganism is a slippery one. When the complete genus and species name for an organism has been introduced, it can be referred to by only the first letter of the genus with the complete species name after it. For example, Escherichia coli is abbreviated as E. coli, but both are always italicized. Looking at microbiology outside the human body. Two important microbiologists helped shape our understanding of the microbial world outside the human body and gave rise to modern-day environmental microbiology. Dutch microbiologist Martinus Beierink was the first to use enrichment culture, specialized chemical mixtures that allow specific organisms to grow, to capture environmental bacteria that weren't easy to grow under normal laboratory conditions. An important example is Azotobacter, which is a nitrogen-fixing bacterium grown in conditions until then thought to be insufficient for life because they contained only nitrogen gas, N2, as the sole nitrogen source. Russian microbiologist Sergei Vinogradsky described sulfur-oxidizing bacteria called begetua from a hot spring. It was this discovery that convinced the field of microbiology that some microbes get energy from inorganic compounds like hydrogen sulfide, H2S, a microbial lifestyle called chemolithotropy. The future of microbiology. Today is perhaps the best time in history to be a microbiologist. The development of new experimental techniques and ability to sequence organisms without actually culturing them in the laboratory first has revealed diversity and complexity in the microbial world not previously known. Most microorganisms can't be grown in the lab, so they were previously unknown before the development of DNA sequencing techniques. Exploiting this microbial biodiversity for drug discovery and biotechnology applications is an exciting area of research. With the widespread availability of antibiotics and vaccines in the last half of the 20th century, infectious diseases were thought to be under control. The emergence of antibiotic resistance and the rapid evolution of bacterial and viral pathogens have made medical microbiology an urgent and exciting field of science. Exciting frontiers. It's an exciting time for microbiology because the tools available to study microbes have improved a lot recently. Molecular biology, the study of nucleic acids such as DNA and RNA, has improved so much that microbiologists are now using molecular tools in many branches of the field. These tools include DNA and RNA sequencing and manipulation, which have allowed microbiologists to understand the function of enzymes and the evolution of microorganisms, and have allowed them to manipulate microbial genomes, the genetic material of organisms. Complete sequencing of microbial genomes is an exciting frontier because it opens the door to knowledge about the varied metabolic diversity in the microbial world. Only a fraction of the many microorganisms on Earth have had their entire genome sequenced, but from those that have, science has learned a lot about microbial genes and evolution. One interesting example of this is the recent sequencing of the complete genome of the strain of Yersinia pestis responsible for the Black Death plague in England that decimated the human population in the 1300s. DNA collected from excavated remains was carefully sequenced to reassemble all the bacterium's genes and showed how this strain is related to the strains of Y. pestis still around today. A rapidly increasing field in microbiology is the study of all the microorganisms and their genes and products from a specific environment, called microbiome research. This exciting new frontier of microbiology is possible because of advances in sequencing technology and has opened our eyes to the unseen diversity of microbial life on Earth. Recent surveys of oceans, for instance, have revealed many times more species of bacteria and archaea than we expected, with untold new metabolic pathways. A popular focus of microbiome research is on the microbes that inhabit the human body. The collection of microbes that naturally live in and on the body are present in everyone and potentially play a huge role in human health and disease. Microbiologists think this is the case because these microbes are present in numbers greater than 10 times those of the cells of the human body. They account for up to 2.5 pounds of the adult body weight and express around 100 times more genes than we do. Research into the microbes of the human body and all their genes is called human microbiome research and has found links between it and everything from weight gain to cancer to depression. Remaining challenges. Microbiology is still a young science, so there are many frontiers yet to explore. For instance, it appears that scientists have described only the tip of the iceberg for the variety of microbial life on Earth. In particular, the variety of viruses that infect humans are not all known. Plus, the many varieties of viruses on Earth are hard to even estimate. The study of cures for viral diseases is still a major challenge, with viruses like HIV and influenza remaining a significant challenge. Viruses like polio and measles that have been essentially eradicated in developed countries still kill and disfigure children around the world in developing countries. As recently as 2014, India was declared polio-free, only after more than $2 billion was spent mounting a massive vaccination campaign. However, infectious diseases like pneumonia are still the number one cause of childhood death around the world because vaccines are hard to deliver in developing countries. Research is ongoing into protection from diseases like malaria and tuberculosis. Vaccination has not proven effective for these diseases that hide from the immune system. Other strategies against malaria include infecting mosquitoes, the insects that infect humans with the disease, with bacteria that kill the malaria parasite. But research is ongoing. Vaccines are effective for prevention of infectious disease, but it's antibiotics that are used to effectively treat active infections. After the golden age of antibiotic discovery came a long period of reliance on antibiotics by modern medicine. They were so effective in treating most infections that we became complacent about their use. We're now entering the antibiotic resistance phase where most, if not all, of the antibiotics we now use are becoming useless against the rise of antibiotic-resistant pathogens. This has become such a serious problem that in the spring of 2014, the World Health Organization declared antibiotic resistance a global health crisis. The fields of microbiology. Since the 19th century, there has been an explosion of great microbiological research, leading to many different branches of microbiology, all of which are both basic and applied in nature. Here's a list of the different fields of microbiology that have developed since the discovery of microorganisms. Aquatic, soil, and agricultural microbiology study the microorganisms associated with aquatic, including wastewater treatment systems, soil, and agricultural environments, respectively. Bacteriology is the identification and characterization of bacterial species. Immunology is the study of the body's response to infection by microorganisms. Included within this field is the area of vaccine research, which aims to develop more and better ways of immunizing people from microorganisms that cause life-threatening infections. Industrial microbiology applies the large-scale use of microorganisms to make things like antibiotics or alcohol. Medical microbiology is the study of pathogenic microorganisms that cause infectious disease in humans and animals and ways to prevent and treat infections. Microbial biochemistry aims to understand the enzymes and chemical reactions inside microbial cells. Microbial biotechnology is genetically engineering microorganisms to produce a foreign gene or pathway so that it may either make a product for human use, for example, human insulin, or perform a function that we need, for example, degradation of environmental contaminants. Microbial ecology is the study of microbial diversity in nature, as well as microbial populations and microbial communities and their effects on their environments. This includes nutrient cycling and biogeochemistry, biological, chemical, and physical processes that control the composition of the natural environment. Microbial genetics is the study of the genomes of microorganisms, including how the genetic code varies between microbes and how genes are passed on. Microbial systematics is the study of how microorganisms diversified through time. It includes the naming and organizing of microbial groups with respect to one another. Mycology is the study of fungi, both in terms of their natural habitats and genetics, and in terms of their ability to cause disease in humans, other animals, and plants. Parasitology is the study of parasites in animals and humans. These are all eukaryotic, not bacterial or archaeal, and include protists and worms. Virology is the study of viruses and simple non-viral entities, such as viroids, RNA molecules that behave like infectious agents, and prions, proteins that behave like infectious agents. Chapter 3. Microbes. They're everywhere, and they can do everything. In this chapter, uncovering microbial life, seeing the variety of microbial metabolism, connecting with microorganisms. We tend to think of microorganisms as the causes of diseases, like polio, the plague, and pneumonia, or inconveniences, food spoilage, the common cold, and garden plant diseases. But the truth is that they play a much larger role in our lives. A balanced microbial community is important for the health of an ecosystem, our health, and the health of our pets and gardens. It's convenient to think of the microbial world only as it pertains to our daily lives, but in reality, microorganisms far outweigh all other life on Earth in terms of genetic variety and the sheer number of cells, some 2.5 times 10 to the power of 30 by recent calculations. Based on the best estimates of biologists, life appeared on Earth almost 4 billion years ago. Multicellular life appeared 2.5 billion years later. But in the meantime, single-celled organisms ruled the Earth. Early prokaryotes, bacteria and archaea, lived without oxygen. The Earth's atmosphere was anoxic, without oxygen, and then slowly changed to one where oxygen levels were sufficient to support life dependent on oxygen. The early Earth also had a much harsher climate than the planet does today. Evidence of microbes that can tolerate extreme conditions are still with us. Evidence of the existence of those different organisms can be observed if you look at the evolutionary tree of life on Earth today. Many different branches of microbes exist. The more distant branches represent the amount of difference in the genetic material between organisms. Looking at the distant branches for microbes shows that the genetic diversity of microbial life is vast compared with that of animals, where the branches are closer together. Technical stuff. A microbial population is a group of cells that are genetically similar to each other, sometimes called a species. These populations live together in groups with other microorganisms in microbial communities. These communities interact extensively with each other and their direct environment, called a habitat, consuming nutrients and excreting waste. The environment is the conditions outside the cell and is often discussed in contrast to the conditions inside the bacterial cell. Microbial communities live within the wider context of an ecosystem, which can include things like lakes, oceans, or forests. Microorganisms have a profound effect on ecosystems, acting to cycle many of the important elements within it. In this chapter, we cover two types of diversity among organisms, habitat diversity and metabolic diversity, and then discuss how the presence of microorganisms affects higher life forms like plants and humans. Technical stuff. The term diversity describes the variety of possible genes, metabolites, habitats, and so on. Biodiversity refers to the variety of live organisms. Habitat diversity. The habitat is an important concept in biology and microbiology in particular because microorganisms are greatly affected by where they live. Microbial habitats, including soils, rivers, lakes, oceans, on the surface of living and dead things, inside other organisms, on man-made structures, and everything in between, provide nutrients and protect cells from harsh conditions. The more places we look for microbes, the more microbes we find. Every environment is stratified, arranged in layers, in terms of the degree of temperature, oxygen, nutrients, and sunlight present. These stratifications make up different niches to which a specific microorganism or group of microorganisms is uniquely suited. Over the billions of years that microorganisms have been on Earth, they've evolved to fit perfectly almost every niche. They really are everywhere. Many habitats on Earth have extreme temperatures, pH, salinity, and/or acidity, and because of this, they're inhospitable to most animals and plants. Instead of being devoid of life, these environments are rich in microbial life. Microbes live at the depths of the ocean and in the highest clouds. They thrive at extremely high temperatures, near hydrothermal vents, and extremely low temperatures inside polar sea ice. Microorganisms can be found at extremes of pH, salt, and dryness, but they're also very abundant and ubiquitous at all conditions in between. In addition, some microorganisms are resistant to substances toxic to most life. The microorganisms often use these substances for energy and, in the process, detoxify them. Everywhere you look, you find microbes, even in places that you may not expect. Surgical suites, NASA clean rooms, specially designed rooms with special air handling and disinfection so that they're free of any microbes. The human brain, and the subterranean caves. For every system that has been designed to keep out microbes, there is a microbe that has circumvented it. This is because microorganisms are the masters of adaptation, and because there are so many different microbes adapted to so many different conditions. What this means is that, despite our best efforts, microbes can sometimes be very difficult to get rid of. The number of microbial cells is not the same in each habitat. Some locations host a large number of bacterial cells, called a biomass, whereas others have a large number of different bacterial species or groups. For instance, the colons of animals are home to maybe the largest biomass of bacterial cells anywhere, with estimates of 10 to the 10th power cells per gram. However, the number of different bacterial groups are thought to be in the range of 100 or 200. In contrast, the most diverse habitat, containing the largest number of bacterial species, is probably soil, with somewhere around 500,000 species in a gram of soil. Environments with mixed nutrient sources often have high microbial diversity because many different microbes can grow without one taking over completely. So the total number of microbes is lower, but the number of different species is higher. In some cases, microorganisms have made their own habitats and grow in large multi-species communities that are obvious to the naked eye. An obvious example of this are microbial mats, which can include many different species of bacteria and archaea. Microbial mats contain a wealth of lifestyle and metabolic diversity and are discussed in detail in Chapter 11. Another, slightly different type of microbial community, called a consortium, involves a more intimate relationship between a smaller number of different microbial species. Two examples of this are lichen and the green sulfur bacterial consortium of marine and freshwater environments. Metabolic diversity. Not only are microorganisms extremely widespread, but within the microbial world, there is also an impressive number of different metabolic pathways. We know this because of the compounds that they consume and produce, as well as from the study of microbial genes found in nature. Recently, scientists have been able to sequence the full genomes of many microorganisms, giving us access to the sequences of all the genes present. This offers a glimpse into the metabolic potential of a microbe, because knowing the genes present can suggest which enzymes the microbe can make and use for its metabolism. Four broad categories of metabolic diversity include the main energy-gathering strategy used, strategies for obtaining carbon, essential enzymes for growth, and products not essential for survival called secondary metabolites. Getting energy. There are three sources of energy in nature. Organic chemicals, those containing carbon-carbon bonds. Inorganic chemicals, those without carbon-carbon bonds. Light. Chemoorganotrophy is the type of metabolism where energy comes from organic chemicals, whereas chemolithotrophy is the type of metabolism where energy comes from inorganic chemicals. Phototrophy involves turning light energy into metabolic energy in a process called photosynthesis, and it comes in two main forms. Oxygenic photosynthesis generates oxygen and is used by the cyanobacteria, a type of bacteria, and algae, a eukaryote, as well as all living plants. Anoxygenic photosynthesis does not make oxygen and is used by the purple and green bacteria. types of bacteria that live in anaerobic, aquatic environments. Capturing carbon. All living cells need a lot of carbon, which is part of all proteins, nucleic acids, and cellular structures. Organisms that use organic carbon are called heterotrophs. Chemoorganotrophs fall into this category. Organisms that use carbon dioxide, CO2, for their carbon needs are called autotrophs. Most chemolithotrophs and phototrophs are also autotrophs, which makes them primary producers in nature because they make organic carbon out of inorganic CO2 that is then available for themselves, chemoorganotrophs, and eventually all higher life forms. Some organisms can switch between heterotrophy when organic carbon is available and autotrophy when food sources run out. These organisms are called mixotrophs. Making enzymes. Few compounds in nature are not degraded by microorganisms. The variety of compounds produced by them is great and not completely known. Their metabolic processes are essential for environmental nutrient cycling, and they are the primary producers that support all other life on Earth. Microbes are specialists at degrading compounds, from the simplest to the most complex and everything in between. They're the only ones able to degrade resistant plant material, fiber, made from cellulose, building blocks used by plants to make their tough cell walls, and lignin, building blocks used by plants for rigid structure, as in wood and straw. The microbes in the rumen, part of a cow's or related animal stomach, of herbivores and the guts of termites, are responsible for digesting these tough plant fibers. Fungi and bacteria are the masters of producing special enzymes to degrade complex food sources, hydrolytic enzymes, including all forms of plant and animal tissues, some plastics, and even metals. Secondary metabolism. Microbial products that are not produced as part of central metabolism and are not essential for everyday activities are called secondary products. Many of these products are bioactive compounds useful in interacting with other organisms. Antibiotics are an example of a secondary product used to interact with other microbes. Some plant pathogens produce substances that mimic plant hormones so that they can manipulate plant growth. Other microbes make molecules that are useful in communicating with other microorganisms, insects, and plants. Knowledge of the metabolism of microorganisms can be used in a variety of ways. One way is to try to isolate them in culture. This isn't always easy. There are many gaps in our knowledge of the metabolic diversity of most microorganisms. It is relatively easy to recreate the temperature and oxygen conditions, but in order to select for the organism you want and select against all the other organisms, you have to know one specific condition that is needed just for your organism of choice. Here are some other ways that the knowledge of microbial metabolism has been useful in the advancements of science. Microbial enzymes are used in molecular biology research. Bacterial enzymes, such as TAC DNA polymerase, used for reproducing sequences of DNA, and restriction enzymes, used to manipulate pieces of DNA in a cut-and-paste fashion, have become invaluable research tools. Microbes are used to express animal proteins or enzymes, such as insulin. When scientists discover that a disease can be cured or treated with a certain protein or enzyme, it becomes very useful and efficient for them to be able to mass-produce the molecule in microbes. Microbial systems are used as part of microscopic machines in synthetic biology. To conduct further research, scientists make use of what we know to push the envelope of engineering and genetics. Scientists use microbial processes to their fullest potential to create new things within organisms. Industrial processes have taken advantage of the diversity of microbes in the food, pulp and paper, mining, and pharmaceutical industries, to name but a few. Because some microorganisms are tolerant of extreme conditions, the enzymes they produce are useful in industrial settings where conditions can be harsh. Because scientists don't know all the metabolic diversity in the microbial world, they haven't been able to isolate in culture a vast number of environmental microbes. This has resulted in huge gaps in knowledge about all the microbial groups that exist. The term microbial dark matter has been coined to describe the vast number of microbial lineages for which scientists know very little, and in most cases, almost nothing. Like the dark matter of the universe that makes up the majority of matter, microbial dark matter is enormous and likely outweighs the known biodiversity of the Earth by several orders of magnitude. The intersection of microbes and everyone else. Microorganisms that live on and inside other organisms have often adapted to interact with their host organism. There are different kinds of relationships between the host organism and microorganisms that live on or in the host. Benign. Organisms that live in or on us and are neither harmful nor recognized by our bodies. They're present, living happily, and our bodies essentially ignore them most of the time. Friendly. Organisms that live in or on us and are not harmful. Our bodies recognize that the organisms are present and also recognize that these bacteria are not harmful, so our bodies don't react to them. Mutually beneficial. Organisms that live in or on us and provide us with a benefit, like making vitamins that we can't make ourselves. We, in turn, provide the organisms with benefits, such as nutrients and a home. Antagonistic. Organisms that cause us harm, as in the cases of viruses where our cells are taken over to produce more virus and are eventually killed. Research is still being done to determine to what extent the human body's immune system recognizes and reacts to the friendly, non-harmful bacteria that live in and on us. For every living organism on the planet, there is a microbial pathogen, a disease-causing organism, perfectly suited to plague it. Some microbes are nasty pathogens that infect their host, subvert their defenses, and wreak havoc in the form of severe illness and sometimes death. Other microbes produce toxins that cause nasty effects on their target. These include microbes that infect animals, plants, insects, invertebrates, and so on. There are even microbes that infect other microbes. On the other hand, there are accidental infections that result when a person with a compromised immune system comes into contact with a microorganism that is common in the environment but can survive in the warm, moist habitat of the human body. These include yeasts, fungi, and bacteria, such as species of bacillus, the pseudomonads, acinetobacter, and clostridium. Pathogenic microorganisms have even been found to have shaped their host's evolution. A chilling example of this was recently discovered by looking for the effects of the plague of the Middle Ages on the evolution of people in Western Europe. Researchers found that genes for immunity were different in people whose ancestors had been exposed to the bacterial pathogen than in those whose ancestors weren't. They also found that genes related to the autoimmune disorders were affected, suggesting that a pathogen can have a profound impact on its host's evolution. Part 2. Balancing the Dynamics of Microbial Life. Web Extras. Find out the truth about antibacterial soaps and hand sanitizers in an article at dummies.com/extras/microbiology. In this part, see the different shapes of microbial cells and get a basic understanding of how cells function. get to the bottom of metabolism, including how microbes make energy from their food and store this energy for later. Understand microbial genetics, from the importance of DNA to how genes can change and the ways in which genes are turned on and off. Find out about microbial growth, how picky microbes can be, and the length scientists will go to in order to get the conditions in the lab just right. Find out about the four different types of clean when it comes to microbes and how the presence of unwanted microbes is controlled. Chapter 4. Understanding cell structure and function. In this chapter, getting the basics of cell structure. Understanding how cells move things in and out. Finding out about cell division and locomotion. Microbiologists know a lot about microbial cells, considering that they're too tiny to see with the naked eye. Research on bacterial, archaeal, and eukaryotic cells has given us a glimpse into how these cells are put together and how they differ from one another. In this chapter, we give a bird's-eye view of the structure of microbial cells. Then we go into some of the most important structures in detail. We discuss major differences between microbes. For instance, what differs between eukaryotic and prokaryotic microorganisms, as well as things that all cells have in common. Seeing the shapes of cells. We know that prokaryotic cells come in many different shapes and sizes because we can look at them under a microscope. A description of the shape of a cell is called the cell morphology. The most common cell morphologies are cocci, spherical, and bacilli, rods. Cocci bacillus are a mix of both, while vibrio are shaped like a comma, spirilla are shaped like a helix, a spiral, sort of like a stretched-out slinky, and spirochetes are twisted like a screw. Although prokaryotes are unicellular organisms, their cells can be arranged in a few different ways, like chains or clusters, depending on how the cells divide. Cocci bacteria that divide along a single plane form small chains of two cells called diplococci, or long chains of multiple cells called streptococci. Cocci bacteria can also divide along multiple planes to form tetrads, two planes, cube-like, sarsini, three planes, or grape-like clusters called staphylococci, multiple planes. Similarly to the cocci, rod-shaped bacteria can divide to form double-celled diplobacilli or longer chains called streptobacilli. The shape of a cell is encoded in its genes. Although we generally know how cell shape is controlled, the reason behind the many different shapes remains a mystery. Tip. You may notice that some of the morphologies are also the names of bacteria. For example, Streptococcus pneumoniae, Staphylococcus aureus, Bacillus anthracis, and Vibrio cholerae. That's because morphologies are sometimes characteristic of bacterial genera. Warning. Morphology is a descriptive characteristic. It doesn't give you enough information to know exactly what type of bacteria you're looking at or its function. Life on a minute scale, considering the size of prokaryotes. One distinguishing feature of prokaryotic cells is their microscopic size. The average size of a prokaryotic cell ranges from 1 micrometer to 10 micrometers. Eukaryotic cells, such as those in the human body, are much larger in comparison and range from 10 micrometers to 200 micrometers. Viruses are smaller than prokaryotic cells at 10 nanometers, 0.01 micrometers, to 100 nanometers, followed by subcellular molecules like proteins or chromosomes that are less than 10 nanometers in size. The smallest size that is visible to the naked eye is 100 micrometers. so scientists rely on microscopes to see prokaryotic cells. The size of a cell is actually quite important for its function. Being small comes with its perks. Cells take up nutrients across their surface, and those nutrients then have to diffuse through the cell in order to help the cell grow. Maximizing the surface area and minimizing the total cell volume reduce the distance that nutrients have to travel, decreasing the time it takes to get the nutrients to where they need to go in the cell. Odds and ends of shapes and sizes. Here are some interesting facts about shapes and sizes of cells. The smallest bacteria recorded are nanobacteria. They range in size from 0.05 micrometers to 0.2 micrometers. This size exceeds the lower limit at which scientists had once thought cells could exist. The largest bacterium found, Thiomargarita namibiensis, measures 750 micromoles, which is almost 1 millimeter. Unusual shapes of bacteria include star-shaped, flat square-shaped, and pear-shaped. Pleomorphic prokaryotic cells are shapeshifters that lack a single cell shape. Remember, the higher the surface-to-volume ratio is, the better off the cell is. Prokaryotic cells have found the Goldilocks size, where they maximize the surface-to-volume ratio without running the risk of being so small that they crowd their contents and impair biological processes. The cell, an overview. Before going into detail on what differentiates bacteria from one another, we want to first look at how all bacteria and archaea, which are prokaryotes, differ from eukaryotes. There are distinct differences between these two domains when it comes to structure and cellular components. The details of these differences are addressed later in the chapter. Scaling the outer membrane and cell walls. The barrier between the inside of a cell and its surroundings is the cell wall or the membrane. Because they act as the barrier between the outside world and the cell, these structures need to be strong and function reliably. Cell walls also have to be versatile enough and distinct enough from those in other bacteria to give each bacterium its own identity. Several components make up this unique barrier for the different types of bacteria, and many of these differences are used to help scientists tell bacterial groups apart from one another. By looking at the outer membrane, cell wall, and gram stain characteristic, gram positive versus gram negative, of bacterial cells, we can tease apart the many bacterial groups. Later in this section, we explain what makes archaea so unique. Examining the outer membrane. The plasma membrane borders the cell and acts as a barrier between the inside of the cell and the outside environment. The membrane serves many important functions in prokaryotic cells, including the following: providing sites for respiration and/or photosynthesis, transporting nutrients, maintaining energy gradients, the difference in the amount of energy between the inside of the cell and the outside of the cell, keeping large molecules out. The plasma membrane is made of a phospholipid bilayer. Individual phospholipids are composed of a charged phosphate, head group, and an uncharged lipid, tail group. Because phospholipids contain charged and uncharged components, they're amphipathic. They can interact with both lipid and aqueous solutions. Tip: think of lipid and aqueous solutions as oil and water. They can't really mix and tend to separate. The tails of phospholipids are hydrophobic, repellent of water. So they repel water such that in a solution of water, they arrange tail to tail to limit their contact with it. This tail forms the inner portion of the membrane. In contrast, the head groups are hydrophilic, attracted to water. They face the outer portion of the membrane and directly contact the environment or the cytoplasm, both of which are aqueous. The layer nearest to the extracellular environment is referred to as the outer leaflet, and the layer nearest to the cytoplasm is referred to as the inner leaflet. The hydrophobic nature of the lipids is what makes the phospholipid bilayer impermeable to large, water-soluble molecules. Individual phospholipids contain a phosphate group attached to a glycerol molecule that is attached to two fatty acid tails. Sometimes, additional molecules are attached to the phosphate group of phospholipids. Not all membranes are the same. The phospholipid bilayer is common to eukaryota, archaea, and bacteria, but there are several differences that set their membranes apart. Eukaryotic membranes contain sterols, steroid-containing lipids, such as cholesterol, that strengthen the membrane. Bacterial membranes contain sterol-like molecules called hopanoids, which help strengthen the membrane. The chemical composition of archaeal phospholipids differs from bacterial and eukaryotic phospholipids in four main ways. These differences are a major distinction between the domains. The fat facts. The plasma membrane isn't all just fat. It's almost equally composed of protein. Membrane proteins serve many important biological functions, including motility, adhering to surfaces, sensing and secreting signals, and transporting nutrients. A membrane protein must contain a hydrophobic region that interacts with the hydrophobic region of phospholipids. There are two classes of membrane proteins. Integral proteins are insoluble in aqueous environments and are tucked right in the membrane. Peripheral proteins are soluble in aqueous environments and sit close to the membrane. They contact the membrane itself temporarily or interact with integral proteins. Integral proteins float within the phospholipid bilayer and are able to move laterally like a buoy in a lake that moves back and forth with the movement of the water. Proteins are mobile in the membrane because the membrane's consistency is similar to that of cooking oil. The membrane is studded with many proteins that freely move throughout it. Exploring the cell wall. Cells build up stores of molecules required for growth inside the cell in higher amounts than are found outside the cell. Water naturally wants to flow into the cell to balance the number of molecules inside and outside. But if the cell were to allow this, it would burst like an overfilled balloon. The cell wall allows the cell to withstand this osmotic pressure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.